I'll call this meeting to order at 6 o'clock, February the 28th. Regular meeting of the City Council on Tuesday, February the 28th. We will begin, please, by making sure that your cell phones are in the off position, and we will have the invocation offered by Bill Blackburn, followed by the Pledge of the Flag, led by Roman Garcia. You may stand if you wish.
For the prayer tonight, I'm going to do something that I don't normally do. I'm going to read it. And this is the prayer that I prayed at the dedication of this building in October 2012. Lord God Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, we gather today with anticipation and hope and appreciation as this City Hall is dedicated 123 years after the city of Kerrville was incorporated. Thank you, Lord, that we live in a country where the voices of all the citizens can be heard. At this City Hall, our fellow citizens will work, and we the people will elect city councils to serve here from among our neighbors. May the beauty of this building inspire those who work here, those who deliberate here, and those who make their appeals and do their business here. May the proximity of the City Hall to the Kerr County Courthouse produce increased collaboration for the good of all the residents of this area. And Father, may children born in Kerrville this year look back as young adults and be able to say they grew up in a town where they felt safe and there were people around who challenged them and encouraged them and gave them hope, and they will be proud to call Kerrville their hometown. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
Please place your right hand over your heart and join me in the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, gentlemen, for helping us get started this evening.
Mayor, I would make a motion.
Ma'am.
Agenda, please. Mayor, I'd make a motion as part of our 7.9 of our operating procedures to move item 1 near item 8, the future agenda, and that we bring item 9, our good news announcements, to the very first of the meeting.
Second.
We have a motion and we have a second to change the order of agenda items for this evening's meeting. To move the citizens forum to the end, is that after 8? And to move the announcements forward. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed? Motion carries 3-1. So we will have the citizens forum and remarks at the end of the meeting this evening. So we will follow up with item number 2A, which is a resolution of commendation presented to Kenneth Bledsoe for serving on the Building Board of Adjustment and Appeals. If you could meet me at the front, please. Whereas Kenneth Bledsoe has served as a member of the Building Board of Adjustment and Appeals with the date of service beginning September the 14th, 2010, and whereas Kenneth Bledsoe has served faithfully and dutifully on said board, now therefore be it resolved by the City Council of the City of Kerrville, Kerr County, Texas, that Kenneth Bledsoe be recognized for outstanding service as a member of the Board of Adjustment and Appeals, and that on behalf of the citizens of Kerrville, as well as for ourselves individually, we wish to express our sincere appreciation for contributions to the city and the community passed and approved the 28th day of February, 2017. Thank you very much, Kenneth. We appreciate it. Come back anytime.
Okay. Thank you.
He's always the same.
This is backwards, Martin. Okay, item number 3 is the consent agenda for 3A and 3B. and 3C. Would anyone like to have these removed from the consent agenda for discussion?
No, ma'am.
Having seen none, I will accept a motion to approve.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, please raise your hand. Passes 4-0. And council, we've had a request to move item 6A to this spot in our agenda this evening for Mr. Brown. He has a rehearsal at 6:30 by consensus. Is there anyone opposed?
No.
No? Then Mr. Brown, for item number 6A, if you would give your report.
Thanks very much. I appreciate, first of all, your flexibility. Secondly, as always, I appreciate the opportunity to come and tell you a little bit about how Playhouse 2000 is faring as managers of your Kathleen C. Callow City Center for the Performing Arts. And I appreciate the fact that my PowerPoint slides are now in the right place. And I'm not sure who I should thank for that, but thank you very, very much for putting that in the right spot. I have additional permanent copies of this if anybody would like to have them. But I'd like to start just by offering you a little bit of some of the highlights. This will be kind of an annual report, if you will, on all of 2016. Some of the highlights from 2016. In January, the Symphony of the Hills Pops and the New Buddy Holly Band both had sold out concerts. That was very, very nice for our January to start things off. In February, Robert Earl Keen helped the Hill Country Youth Orchestra raise a little bit more than $30,000, as he will do again here in just a couple of days. In March, we had an election that concluded. More than 5,200 visitors cast ballots, and that one of three different elections that took place in the lobby of the Callow Theater during March. In April, we had the grand opening for the brand new Kit Werlein Annex, which was made possible in large part by a grant from the Economic Improvement Corporation. And Larry Gatlin was by, and he had a full house, and we were real pleased about that. May, we set aside almost exclusively for Kerrville ISD events. Tybee High School in particular had events there. The band and the choirs, and this year the School of Dance will be added to that list. We also had their end of year events for teachers, and all of those awards for seniors, those kinds of things, all took place in May. And once again, we were the host for more than 4,000 voters. In June, Shakespeare in the Park was not quite in the park due to rain, so it moved back over to the Callow Theater. And the Lone Star Dance Co-op from Bernie came up and sold out the house twice. We were real excited to be bringing in some folks from Bernie for that. In July, the Butt Holdsworth Library Summer Reading events were actually both June and July. Every Wednesday at about 10 in the morning, the young people from the area join us at the Callow Theater for those reading events. And we sold about 1,000 tickets to our summer musical, which was a lot of fun. Then in August, our summer musical theater camp for young performers happened, and our Steinway grand piano finished a renovation. A lot of that was also paid by the EIC, and we had a coming home concert for that featuring James Dick. It was a wonderful event. In September, the Young People's Performances relaunched for the season. The Step Crew was here, and they had more than 1,400 students in attendance. August, September, October. Yeah, October is the next month. I thought I was out of order somehow. The Symphony of the Hills school shows, once again, were completely full. Lots of students. And, once again, more than 4,000 voters. In November, TAPS, which is the Texas Association of Private and Parochial Schools, hosted their state one-act play festivals at the Callow Theater. It's a series of four levels of one-act play festival, and it brought more than 1,200 visitors to Kerrville for that 1 week. And then in December, we had 8 events over the course of the first 3 weeks of December, seen by nearly 4,000 guests. So as you can see, it was a very full year. There we go. By the numbers, the 2016 totals, we had 90 separate events during 2016. An event would be anything that has a single title to it. But that included 187 lit nights, which means that, for instance, our summer musical was A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum. That is a single event, but because there were 7 performances, those were 7 lit nights. 187 lit nights is a very full year for us. Total attendance across the year was 52,900. That includes both paying guests and visitors like voters who attend without paying. But that is 28% more in terms of event nights, lit nights, and total attendance, 28% above what it was in 2015. Because a big portion of those 28% were non-paying guests, in particular voters, we did have 10% more face value of tickets sold than we had in 2015, which is a very significant number for us. Total ticket face value for 2016 to date was $510,366 in face value tickets sold. There are economists who do a better job of it than I do to tell you what that $500,000 worth of ticket face value translates to in economic impact to the city of Kerrville and to the county and to our area. I won't venture to guess what that is, but we like to say that we have about $1.5 million worth of economic impact in a year that includes $500,000 of ticket sales. Our financial activity during 2016 as an operating company, we had total operating income of $600,795 and total operating expense of $583,255. So our net operating income for 2016 was $17,540. That's 3% net income, which is reasonably healthy for a nonprofit organization that's in the business that we are in. There's a little graph here. I should mention we had available operating cash at the end of the fiscal year of $94,131. This little graph shows the progress of total income across the years from 2011 through 2016. And you'll notice that we have progressed across total income. The orange section there is earned income, while the bottom section is unearned and contributed income. You'll notice, and we're going to talk about this a little bit more in a second, 2014 was our strongest year prior to 2016 in unearned income. That included some one-time grants that carried across the fiscal year. Our net income figures are also marked from 2011 to 2016. We've had positive net income in four of the past 6 years. 2015 was negative net income specifically related to those one-time grants that arrived for us in 2014 and held over across the fiscal year. So we actually have had positive net income in all of our current fiscal years for the last 5 years. Our development activity, our annual fund and other operational donations during 2016 raised about $48,000. Our business and foundation support was about $77,000. And this little graph will show you how earned income compares across the last 5 years, as I just mentioned to you. And I would encourage you, if you have an opportunity, to hold the date. Our annual gala, Dinner with the Stars 2017, is on Saturday, March 25th, 2017. If you have not already received an invitation to that, I will make sure that you get one. We would love to see all of you there. So a few highlights of upcoming events. In March of 2017, the Hill Country Youth Orchestras are back with their concert featuring Robert Earl Keen. He has invited a special guest, Lee Ann Womack, a very exciting concert for all of us. That concert is virtually sold out at the moment. Charity Productions will be back in the month of March with The Letterman and their special guest, Mary Sarah, who was a star of The Voice in season 10. Then in April, the Calo Performances Series will finish their current season with an outstanding group from England called Semi-Toned, their show called Sing Theory. They recently were named Best in Britain on BBC2's program called The Choir. They are an outstanding a cappella ensemble, and I hope everybody gets a chance to hear them. And then the Symphony of the Hills will be in to finish up their year with Mostly Mozart. In May, Tybee High School will be back, their choir, band, dance, and all their end-of-the-year celebrations. And our youth theater will present Peter Pan. And then as we look over into the rest of the year, if you will, Carousel will be our summer musical this year, starting on June the 30th. Our summer musical theater camp will present Cinderella. The Calo Performances Series will launch for 2017-18. on October the 27th with a group called Beginnings, which is a tribute to the band Chicago. So it's going to be an exciting year for us. And I don't want to be anything less than answer. I don't want to do any less than answer all your questions, but I want it to be succinct. So that is my full report, but I'd be happy to answer any questions at this moment.
Thank you so much, Jeffrey.
You're welcome.
Great presentation. I would like a copy of that. And that's
sure.
Good for our files.
Happy to do that.
Any questions from the council?
Jeffrey does an incredible job. I'm the liaison or the member from the City Council on the Playhouse 2000 board, and they run a tight ship over there. Jeffrey does an incredible job with his staff, and we're
very
blessed to have him.
Say thank you for the days when the voters and the symphony were there together.
We have gotten adept at making the campus do more than one thing at a time.
We appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you all for your time. I appreciate it.
If you got a spare, I'll take one.
There we go.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Jeffrey.
Thank you, sir.
Appreciate you.
I'm sorry, so the motion, we have a correction. The motion was also to move the announcements to the first part. Okay, so at this point, we will retrofit, and we will go into Ms. Berry, our announcements portion.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. The City of Kerrville would like to make all residents aware of an important change to the annual property tax collection process. Starting tomorrow, March 1st, Kerr County will begin collecting all property taxes on behalf of the City of Kerrville. Payment of city property tax was formerly handled through the Kerrville Independent School District Tax Office. However, as of tomorrow, all city property taxes should be paid through the Kerr County Tax Assessor Collector Office. If you are currently on a payment plan, please contact both the Kerr County Tax Office and the Kerrville ISD Tax Office for your new payment amounts. Please make checks payable to Kerr County Tax Assessor Collector. Also, starting tomorrow, March 1st, voting begins for the March Madness Battle of the Books at the Buttholdsworth Memorial Library. Stop by the children's area of the library to vote for your favorite book theme, whether it's wizards, aliens, dinosaurs, or something else. All ages are welcome to participate, and the library will have a party on March 25th to celebrate the theme that wins. You should also plan to stop by the library for some spring break family fun. A special family activity will be held each day, Monday, March 13th through Thursday, March 16th. Special events include a kids' craft, a family movie afternoon, and the popular Lego Club. And you can stop by the library to pick up a spring break flyer for more information about any of these events. Registration is still open for the Adult Flag Football League. The deadline to register is next Monday, March 6th. Contact the Parks and Recreation Department at 830-257-7300 for more information on creating or joining a team for this year's league. And finally, tonight, the City of Kerrville is currently accepting applications for lifeguards to work at the Olympic Pool for the summer season. Applicants must be at least 16 years old and available to work regularly from late May through the end of July, and some of August potentially. The starting pay is $8.75 an hour, and the Ellis & Associates lifeguard training is provided through the Parks and Recreation Department. Applications are available here at City Hall or online at kerrvilletx.gov. Don't delay, be sure to apply soon as positions are limited and that special training is conducted in the early spring.
Thank you, Ms. Berry. Any other announcements from council? Having heard none, we will continue on item number 4A, which is acceptance of the fiscal year 2016 City of Kerrville Comprehensive Annual Financial Report. Ms. Curtin? And by the way, for those of you who just joined us at 6, we had a special meeting at 5 where she graciously, along with our financial staff here in-house, went through all of the audit for 2016, and so that will be available for the public. I don't know when, but shortly. So she's here to give an overview of what we did at 5.
Yes, ma'am. Honorable Mayor White and members of the City Council, BKD performed audit planning in October and field work in November of 2016. We have provided the City Council a final draft of the comprehensive annual financial report, and the report is scheduled to be issued by the end of the week. As a result of the procedures performed for the year ended September 30th, 2016, BKD will issue two reports as follows: the independent auditor's report on the financial statements and the independent auditor's report on internal control over financial reporting and on compliance and other matters based on an audit of the financial statements performed in accordance with government auditing standards. Each report contains an unmodified or clean opinion, and there were no material weaknesses or significant deficiencies in internal control that were identified as part of the audit procedures performed. During fiscal year 2016, the city received the Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting for its 2015 Comprehensive Annual Financial Report. This was the 32nd consecutive year that the city received the prestigious award. We expect that the city will receive the same award next year for its 2016 Comprehensive Annual Financial Report. The city had a good year financially. The city's net position increased by $5.06 million, driven primarily by capital and operating contributions made primarily by the generous Kerrville community, as well as increases in property tax and sales tax collections. We wish to formally thank Sandra Yarbrough, Amy Dozier, and the entire finance department for their assistance and cooperation and preparedness during the audit. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you may have regarding the presentation.
Any questions by council? We had a quite thorough summary.
Yes, ma'am.
Overview, and so that will be available, as I mentioned, to the public at the end of the week. And we're very thankful, as Ms. Curtin mentioned, that the city is in good financial shape. And Sandra and Amy, would y'all stand? I want to appreciate y'all. Let's give them a round of applause. We have a lot of confidence in them. That having been said, were there any questions this evening from the public? If not, I will accept a motion to accept the fiscal year 2016 City of Kerrville Comprehensive Annual Financial Report.
So moved. So moved.
We have a motion and we have a second. All in favor, please raise your hand. Passes 4-0. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Item number 4B. Is abandonment of the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality Water Use Permit number 3635 and termination of upstream diversion contract with GBRA. Mr. Hoppe.
Thank you, Mayor. Good evening, Mayor and Council. We have an item before you tonight with the council goal of being good stewards of public resources. Staff has evaluated a water use permit that is not being utilized. However, we are continuing to pay taxpayer resources on that permit every year, and we have that permit for another 4 years. So we brought this item before you tonight to weigh the policy decision of whether to continue that permit or to go ahead and abandon that permit since it is not being utilized. I'd like to ask Mr. Stuart Barron to the podium to further brief the City Council.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Here to talk a little bit about water right number 3506. It is a golf course, is a water right on the golf course.
Can you raise your mic up a little bit? Thank you.
Sorry. sorry. So water right, we inherited the water right, or the water right came with the golf course. It has not been used since about 2002, when there was a flood that washed out a lot of the infrastructure there. The city of Kerrville actually extended our wastewater reuse lines to the golf course, and since that time, we've been using our reuse water. We did look at moving the water right to the city of Kerrville water treatment plant. There is some cost associated with that. We feel it's about $55,000 to do that. We'd also lose our seniority to all those water lights along the way, and we'd also lose a quantity of the water through that process. In addition to, we would also have to update our upstream diversion contract with GBRA, which is a take-or-pay contract. If we use the water or not, we pay for it every year. This year, in 2016, we used about 48% of our water rights, the surface water rights, and so we feel that allowing this to be terminated would be acceptable if that's what council desires.
And I do remember last year when you brought this forward for consideration, and everyone is always a little skeptical about when you mention losing water rights, but I do believe I understand you know, what you're saying, the purpose this is, and I know that there's going to be a little different configuration out at the golf course. So right now, this creek comes down, and there's a dam that impounds the water. That dam has been damaged, and that's a different discussion. But maybe we discussed it, too, to alleviate some of the flooding issues, too. We'll talk about the dam later, but I understand that we don't need this at this point. We can't really utilize it for drinking water.
Right.
So I understand. I'm in agreement. I don't know if there's any questions from council.
Just one quick question, Stuart. This
yes,
no way impacts our ability to recreate the dam. We just can't pull the water out of it, right?
No, sir. This water right gave the city the authority to build the dams and to have them. If we terminate this water right, then we would have to breach the dams, and that water would have to be allowed to flow down the creek.
Okay.
Any other questions? I didn't have any speaker request forms. Are there any questions from the public? If not, I would entertain a motion to, based on the staff's analysis, to abandon this permit and terminate the contract and take all other necessary actions related thereto.
So moved.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries 4-0. Thank you. We've also had a request by management to rearrange 4C and 4D, if that's all right, by consensus from council, because it fits better in their plan. So if there's no objections, we will go to item number 4D first. And that would be to rearrange the order of the city council meeting agenda. Mr. Davis, you wanted to present this.
Thank you, Mayor. As a result of your work session, which was held February the 21st, you discussed rearranging the agenda by moving the announcements of community interest to the front of the agenda, and then moving the visitor citizen forum to the end of the agenda. And this is just a follow-up of that discussion, and we put it on the agenda tonight so that y'all could formally consider it.
Are there any questions or comments by council?
I would propose that we move forward this. I think there's all kinds of comments one way or the other. We've experienced it. I think it sets the right tone when we start off with good positive stuff. We typically finish fairly early. One of the unusual things that Kerrville allows is people to discuss any topic, any issue, any item on the agenda. So citizens have an amazing access to the council. Many towns, you don't get that opportunity. You get only in public hearings or at the public forum, and some cities don't even have public forum. So I think this sets the proper tone, and I'm an advocate of moving it. I like the way it's flowed. I think it sets a proper tone for the council, and would be willing to make a motion if you're ready.
I think the way we decided we would do it is take questions first, and then we'd take public comments.
Okay, that's right.
Move to that. So I do have several speaker requests from Peggy McKay.
Peggy McKay, P.O. Box 291464, Kerrville. I disagree with the proposal to move the visitors forum from the early agenda of city council meetings and place it close to the end. In the workshop last week, Mrs. Summerlin stated her belief that, in a quote, "we have gotten into a place where we are offering an inappropriate soapbox to some people to just vent." I noticed the night I asked that we put it to the end, it made somebody inconvenienced. We get fired up to get busy on city business, say the pledge, have a prayer, it's all positive. Then the ranting and raving, it just sucks the energy out of the room. If you don't agree with me and you think people need to come and vent, please at least put it at the end. And end of her quote. Actually, at that mentioned meeting, three people requested to speak at the citizens forum. Two left, not because they were inconvenienced, but because they had children to tend to. Believe their comments would have been early on and had no choice about staying for the entire meeting. Mr. Andrews mentioned in the meeting that his 21-year experience in meetings, Citizens Forum was placed at the end. But a letter to the editor in today's newspaper related a 20-year following of Kerrville's council meetings with the forum near the beginning. Others suggest it has always been that way. I researched the agendas of 25 Texas cities, and only five put their citizens forum at the end of the meeting. One, Portland, had only two agenda items, and the forum occupied the second position. Perhaps unintended, this proposal, which had majority support at the workshop, sends a message to the citizens that we're simply tolerated and our input or comments have little merit. I request that the visitors forum not be moved.
Thank you very much.
And I do have a list of the 25 cities.
Thank you. Jerry Wolf.
My name is Jerry Wolf, and I live at 509 North Buckboard. I don't want to get over dramatic about this a bit, but 221 years ago, I've gotten mixed up with the American Revolution and the Texas Revolution. But this time, in 1836, the Siege of the Alamo was on. It ended 5 days, 6 days from now, on March the 6th. And the reason that those men were there, 180 men, the soldiers, were there for one reason, that was to fight for democracy. One version or one expression of that democracy is to be able to come before a governing body and express your opinion. If this council deems that the citizens' opinions are of such low esteem or of low importance to put it at the end of the agenda of a meeting, that kind of says something. This is what not this state or this country was founded upon. It was founded upon rebel rousers. Democracy is supposed to be vocal, raucous. And by putting this at the end, you're diminishing people coming forward here to speak. Like Mrs. McKay just mentioned, two people came here with small children. They couldn't stay for the entire meeting. They didn't get a chance to express their opinion. So I very much urge you, for the sake of democracy and free speech, that you leave this agenda item at the very early part of the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. George Baroudi.
George Baroudi, 1616 Glen Road. Just to say that the proposal in front, I would say the announcements moving to the front, that seems like a no-brainer. I think that makes a lot of sense. But moving the visitors forum, you got to ask the question, what's broke and why are we changing it? It's kind of irrelevant what other towns do. It's really a matter of we're at starting point A, visitors forum at the front, and why are we moving it to the end? And in that workshop that they've all talked about, really the only thing that was being attempted was to minimize or reduce the number of ranting and ravings or whatever that goes on. And you already have that in your rules. You're allowed to shut down people that are talking irrelevant things or being rude or whatnot. The real consequence that goes on is you're sending one very loud symbol to the citizens, which is, it's not that they're not important, what they're saying, it's that you're saying you actually are attempting to discourage the input from the citizens. And that's the part that needs to be addressed. Is when you push it to the end, when it's been at the front, that's really what you're doing. And you're going to later talk about the community survey that you're doing. And we hear the council talk about the lack of engagement from the community. And the visitors forum is their opportunity to engage. And to move it to the end is going to do only one thing, and that's you're going to lose some people from speaking in that. you're probably not going to lose the ranters and ravers anyways, because they're going to stay to make that rant and rave. It's the other people that you're supposedly trying to get involved in this process that are going to not come in. And I would just urge you to reconsider that aspect. Move the announcements forward. Leave the visitors forum up. Thanks.
Thank you. Anyone else from the audience who didn't sign wish to speak? Ms. Lipscomb?
Carolyn Lipscomb, 909 Lake Drive. I personally don't have a problem with it being moved to the end. My husband and I have been coming to these meetings for a long time. And one of the things that we have seen is that a lot of times the people who come in to speak, if they had been to some of the meetings, when the meeting was going on, they would have known what was going on themselves and not come in and gotten on to council because they thought it was some other way or they had heard a rumor or whatever. And I would encourage anybody who can to come to the meetings and sit through the meeting. And so often people come in, say their piece, gripe about something which may or may not be true, and then leave, and they still don't learn any more than what they knew when they came in to speak. Thank you.
Thank you. Any discussion by council? I just want to make my one statement, and then we'll move forward with asking for a motion. But I know one of the things that we have on our city website, and I mentioned it in the workshop, is our citizens, our goals for the city council. And number one on that goal is to hear the citizens' voices. And I understand you make a good point that it would be helpful for a lot of people, and y'all have been very faithful to come to the meetings. But there are those who do have other obligations, and they do come back for a particular item that may affect them. So I did speak with the publisher of the Daily Times, who said for 40 years she's been covering council meetings, commission meetings, and other board meetings, and she had never seen one where the visitors section was at the end of the meeting. I do think it's a matter of convenience, and so for all of these reasons I've just mentioned, I am not for changing the order. I believe the visitors forum ought to remain at the first. That having been said, I'll entertain a motion to rearrange the order of the city council meetings to put the visitors at the end.
I would so move.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and we have a second. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed? Motion carries 3-1. We will now go back to our item number 4C, which is a landfill expansion project phase 3. Mr. Hoppe.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. You have a key goal of planning, maintaining, and upgrading infrastructure as one of your city goals. And one of the pieces of infrastructure that often gets overlooked, we often think about waterways and sewers, sewer lines and streets. But one of the key assets that we have is our landfill. And that landfill, the city has been in a process of permit expansion with the state for over 2 years now. We've gone through phase one and gone through phase two. We're now ready to move towards phase three, but obviously we need to, it has a large expenditure associated with it, and so we needed to come forward to council to get your approval to move forward that. It is an item that has been budgeted in part. There is a fund balance from the landfill account, the reserve account, that is being proposed to be moved over, and there's a healthy balance in there to account for the engineering contract. Now, timeline-wise, let me kind of explain this a little bit. There's a two-step process to the budget amendment. One is on your ordinance. That's the item next up, and then the second reading will be for the March 14th. So the presentation that we have for you tonight is simply, there's no action required for it. It's simply a presentation really on where we're moving. We'll bring the contract to you on March 14th for your approval, assuming that the budget amendment is approved later tonight. So with that, I'd like to ask Mr. David Barrera, our Assistant Director of Public Works, to further brief the City Council.
All right, thank you, EA.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. So we'll go over this presentation of the landfill expansion project. As EA mentioned, we're currently looking to go into phase three. We'll back up a little bit, go on the history of the project itself, which began with an initial solid waste management study in 2014. That was just to look at the existing collection procedures for curbside collections for recycling and garbage, and then also the landfill and transfer station operations and the lifespans of the site. So currently, the lifespan is 7 to 10 years. That's saying if we were to quit transferring waste to San Antonio, the waste generated here in the county would, the landfill would be consumed in 7 to 10 years. So one of the things we looked at was evaluating the long-term options, which is to implement a large scale recycling program for curbside, which we've done. Also look at the options for expanding the existing landfill. By doing so, we can increase the lifespan to approximately 100 years. And we want to secure the expansion permit to avoid any kind of changes to regulations that can happen in the future. So here's a site layout. The existing site, which is lined in black, and then the western portion, which is in blue, and then the Big Hill expansion is down below in yellow. So that takes us to phase one, which was completed in November 2014. Once again, it's just a preliminary assessment to perform geotechnical evaluation, subsurface monitoring with groundwater, and initiate the communications with agencies that are required to communicate with per TCEQ. And ultimately to determine if we're able to even expand the site, if it's feasible, which we were. So that took us to phase two, which was more of a detailed assessment. That was completed in July of last year. Once again, continued subsurface monitoring, various surveys at the request of agencies, obtained additional information from assessments, and then review the reports and the findings from the agencies that we've contacted. And that's where we stand right now as to recommendations to proceed to phase three. Phase three consists of, I'll touch on a couple of items. It's just design and permitting, conduct further studies, surveys, and investigations, prepare the amendment application, which is a four-part application, general information, existing conditions, site development plan, which also includes your actual design of your cells. That's in part three. And part four is your site operating plan. It's a very lengthy application, very detailed. So then you would submit that application to TCEQ, and then they would send any notice of deficiencies. And those are mainly just to clarify certain items of the application. So we'll go to the project funding, which is provided by the Landfill Closure Fund, which was originally at $1.275 million. We transferred over $500,000 for this project. And the current balance in this landfill closure fund after we transferred was approximately $775,000 after that transfer. That's what it sits at right now. And the current balance in the project fund for the expansion is $242,403.52. So we're asking to transfer $257,597 over, and that'll be in the next item. So the next steps, as EA mentioned earlier, which approval of budget amendment to transfer funds. We'll have the first reading tonight, second reading March 14th. On the 14th, we'll also ask for approval to execute a professional service agreement with LNV for phase three. And the timeline, we're looking at LNV to complete a draft application approximately 9 months, submit it to the city. Staff will review and comment. That'll take approximately 3 months. And then we'll submit the application to TCEQ, which that review process can take anywhere from 12 to 24 months. And at this time, if you have any questions from LNV, who's able to answer any questions?
Yeah, I have one clarification. I think that in your statement, you were going to increase the projected usability of the landfill to approximately 100 years.
Correct.
Okay, but as I have come to understand it, we've already used up 30 or 40 of those years, of those 100 years.
No, we have not used any of that.
No,
that
we
projected.
Haven't. So we're going to add 100 years.
In the end, if you add the existing site, you're looking at 110 years with what we have now. Those are separate.
110 year more. This is going to take care of all the landfill for the next 110 years.
Correct.
For 2127.
It's a long time.
Yeah, I'm leery of that, I guess I would say.
Yeah.
And that's filling it, sir, at the current rate that Kerrville's filling it. And so as Kerrville grows, that may come down some.
Okay.
But at our current usage of the
could
airspace
you come
in the
to
land,
the platform, please?
I'm sorry, that's not a guaranteed 120 years.
Well, that's,
but as it is today, as we're producing trash and filling our landfill right now, that's moving it forward at that current rate.
If there's no growth.
Right. Yes, ma'am.
Question for me, please.
But I believe we include growth in the life of the landfill with the projected tonnages that are going on right now. There is an increase in tonnages that are coming in right now. That is accounted for in the lifespan.
Okay, well, I'm just trying to understand whether we got 100 more years.
That's what we're trying to get the expansion
if
permit.
If we executed all this as you would propose and suggest, we'd have 100 more years of landfill capability.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Right now, just to make sure I'm understanding, we have most of our solid waste is transferred to Republic's landfill in the San Antonio area.
That's correct.
Does this assume we continue that, or does this 100 years of our of doing our own waste disposal and not using Republic?
We'll have that option by having our own site.
But it is.
Which one does the 100 year assume?
No transfer. I'm sorry. No transfer.
We have 100 years of this, and so if we continue to transfer, it's even longer than 100 years.
Correct. And you can do both. If we do have that landfill, you have that option of continuing to transfer, but
just want to make sure
you just want to look at the cost.
Assumptions were.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah, we have a contract with Republic Waste through 2030, but that's assuming that they'll continue to allow people to transfer and the waste there. It saves us about 40 tons or some so a year by transferring.
Yeah, that's pretty
correct. Healthy. Yeah, and that's depending on a third party to accept our waste, and that's not guaranteed. So the guarantee is we have our own site, so we can secure disposal needs for this community.
Because adding that 100 years is about, because this was discussed 10 or 12 years plus ago, and the permitting process was dropped back when it was BFI. They dropped the ball on getting it going again. So that 100 years is correct. That was identified, like I said, it's been well over a decade ago, that if we were to permit basically the entire footprint of the property out there or as much as possible, that it could add up to 100 years of life to that. So, and that was before we were transferring to San Antonio.
That's pretty amazing.
Let me ask
it
this.
Is.
I'm sorry, are you not finished?
I am.
Was that, I think each site, we're looking at two, and this is my question. The Western expansion, this is to permit both. The Western expansion and the Big Hill are the South expansion. And I do know initially the Big Hill expansion is what Ms. Hazeltine of LNV recommended because it was not in the floodplain. And there were several other reasons why she mentioned that as the preferred site. The Western extension, which you're including in this, was in the 100 year floodplain. There was a Clomer denied because of that tributary in that area. And there was also a state antiquities landmark site that had to be determined whether that was an antiquities site or not. Now, I don't know if Fries and Nichols did that or not, but I know that there were soil issues. The preferred, is that you, Ms. Hazeltine?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I put a face to the name.
Yeah.
And so I've read your name in here a lot.
Yeah.
But I know that that's what you were recommending was the South option.
Yeah, so the western expansion, the Antiquities of Texas Historical, that was part of our phase one and two. We actually did studies, and we do have clearance from the Texas Historical Commission. And so that property, the western expansion, it is available. And the just clarify, so our Clomer, it wasn't denied. It was just they want a different form of a Clomer submitted. So we're still able to go through that process and get that approved. And so the western expansion is a very feasible option. And it's actually a good location because of the soils that are on that side of the site. So.
And each of those sites is what started my comments, would add 50 years. Is that correct?
Right. So it's all combined. So you have your existing landfill, and with the new excavations and the waste laying up over the other landfill, all of that combined is where that 100 years comes from.
That's what I thought.
Mm-hmm. Just as an educational question, so we've got the side of the hill in the decaying process, I don't know what, decomposition process, whatever. How long is it before you can reuse that site? Or do they not allow that ever?
Are you talking about the old landfill, that closed portion, or
right,
your
existing? Right, well, the side of the hill that I guess it would be
the existing towards the road. So you're asking when can you, build things on it? Is that what you're
not build no. on it. If we wanted to go back and, I mean, there's a deterioration process of the material you've buried.
Right.
Is it feasible, in sometime in the future that you can actually reuse that site for a disposal site, a landfill site?
There's a 30 year.
Not really. That waste is going to be there for a very long time.
Was the question. How long is it? We're talking 100 years. A very long time is.
Yeah, I would say
for
more
those
than,
of us
more
that are
than
getting
that,
old,
I
that's
mean,
a long time.
Yeah, there's old unpermitted landfills that maybe you go out and build a building, you put in auger cast piles, you'll still get waste up from those, and those are back before.
So the answer is no.
Yeah, answer no.
And we can't go higher on that closed landfill either, can we? We can't do a vertical permit. Okay.
There's a restriction, right? And also a 30-year requirement, isn't there?
For the post-closure, it's a 30-year post-closure care that you have to maintain.
That's what we're hiring these folks for, to tell us all these details and get all the paperwork for us. But there's no action on that, right?
So this was a presentation basically about going forward. My last question, I guess, would be where it says in phase three, I guess I'm a little puzzled about phase one, phase two, and maybe this will go into the money part later, because initially I read in some minutes from that February 3rd, 15 presentation that the cost of the permitting process was about $500,000, and indeed you said that's what we transferred over for the project. You're going to be asking us in the next item to entertain an overage of up to $750,000 is what the budget amendment.
An additional $250,000 is what we're asking to go over the $500,000, which was anticipated. It was an estimated cost, but we also included that second portion to expand, which was the western portion.
So that was in addition to the original.
Yes.
Because the other thing that I noticed is that eight times in the LNB presentation and in the contract, which I have here, they talked about combining sources with freeze and nickels to reduce that cost, because indeed there were boring, soil testing, archaeological, biological, depth to groundwater, floodplain, hydrological, all those studies. Are we ever going to get an analysis maybe of what we were able to save? I think freeze and nickels did those portions of the
During phase one and phase two, LNB did coordinate with freeze and nickels to combine some of the assessments, so that was achieved.
But we're still going to be short.
Yes.
Portion. By the way, in the town hall meeting, the representative from Friesen Nichols said he wasn't aware of an LNB study, but eight times it was mentioned in your presentation and in your contract that y'all were coordinating efforts, and I know that you did, and that was a smart thing to do. So what you're asking is just that we entertain this western expansion permitting and Big Hill expansion, both of those sections?
Both as a whole,
as a whole.
A complete landfill expansion project.
And there will be the Clomer was prepared in phase two, but there'll be another in phase three, I presume. And you'll come back to us next meeting with that contract? Is that what you said? March 14th?
On March 14th, after the second reading of the budget transfer.
The Clomer they filed, they just have to refile it with FEMA. The one they filed was a Clomer F based on fill. Uh-huh. They just need a Clomer without the additional fill comment on it. So that'll be relatively easy to do. They will dovetail it in with the work that Fries and Nichols has already done and verify that those don't conflict each other. They've been sharing information. We've been sharing information with them. We'll have all that ironclad between the two agencies. The benefit, one thing that we haven't told you yet is establishing this landfill for 100 years, it grandfathers us in. I think that's something we haven't talked about in this session, but we talked to previous councils about. If we can get our permit from TCEQ and have that permit in hand, it'll give us a lot better negotiating position for any future waste haulers that we may have, if it's BFI or Republic or whomever that might be. And then we can also open our landfill if the council so desires to open it and start taking trash or fill material again. But we need to do this to be ready for that if we're going to have that available to us.
Any other questions from council or comments? If not, are there any questions from the audience? So we don't need an action on this, is that correct, Mr. Davis? This is just for presentation?
Just for presentation.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And thank you for coming. Hazeltine, did I say that correctly? Okay. So at this time, we will go to item 5A, which is ordinance number 2017-08, amending the budget for fiscal year 2017 to account for various changes to the city's operational budget, to account for the transfer of funds for the landfill expansion project, and to accept and allocate revenue from a grant awarded to the city relating to the EMS trauma care system. Ms. Yarbrough.
Good afternoon. Before you, we have the two items. The first one is for the landfill closure to move forward on that from the original budget. And the second item is to record the revenue received from the EMS Trauma Care Center and to allocate those funds to be expended as determined in that grant. On the landfill, and y'all have an amended spreadsheet up there, the request is for $257,597 to be transferred from the landfill fund into the project fund to continue. And on the revenues for the EMS, that will be recorded in the general fund, and the expenditures will be in the general fund also. And that's just to book them.
Did you say that we had an amendment on here?
There was a sheet that was laid on your table from, okay, from the original that was in the agenda.
Okay.
You got it.
All right, I'm sorry. I saw that. I had it with the speaker request forms. So we just amended the 250,000 as presented, 257,500.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Any questions by council? Any questions? I don't have any speaker request forms for this item. So we're basically asking that we move the funds in from the closure fill
to the project fund.
To the project fund. Mm-hmm. And then we'll still have a chance to approve the contract as it comes.
That's
to
correct.
Okay.
This is the first reading of
all
this
right.
amendment.
All in favor of approval on the first reading of ordinance number 2017-8?
Motion.
Sorry.
I move for approval.
Second.
Well, I knew it was coming. So. We have a motion and second now. All in
now
favor.
Now you can vote.
And it passes 4-0. All right. Item number 6B is the presentation of community survey. Ms. Barrett.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. As you all well know, in November and December of last year, the City of Kerrville coordinated with the National Research Center to conduct a community-wide survey of citizens, as directed by Council in August. And the purpose of this survey was to learn more about the vision Kerrville citizens have for the future of Kerrville, and to get specific data about a number of services that the city currently provides. And tonight, I'm pleased to share with everyone an overview of the results and some key takeaways from that survey. The National Research Center mailed the National Citizen Survey to 1,800 randomly selected households in Kerrville at the start of November. The National Research Center was responsible for selecting each of those addresses randomly through the post office. This map on the screen very generally shows the 1,800 households which received a survey by mail. Now, please keep in mind the map is not exact since it is an anonymous survey, but it does provide a general picture so you can see that the households in all parts of the city were given an opportunity to provide feedback. And any large gaps that you may see on the map are likely parks, schools, commercial areas, bodies of water, or even the airport, as you may see down there in the corner, which even has one little dot from a household in that area. So in order to get an accurate return rate, the number of surveys mailed to empty apartments or vacant homes was subtracted from that initial value of 1,800 surveys sent out. And we did receive approximately 100 returned surveys because they had been sent to those vacant addresses, making our final survey pool about 1,700 households. And by the conclusion of the survey period, the city of Kerrville received 513 responses, which is a return rate of 29% with a 4% margin of error. The National Research Center typically expects a return rate of at least 25% and a margin of error less than 5% for a statistically valid sample. So the city of Kerrville's results fall well within that range and can be considered a highly reliable sample of citizen satisfaction, which is great news when you consider all these results that we're going over here tonight. I will also add that the optional online survey was made available for any citizens who did not receive a copy of that survey by mail. There were 33 respondents to that optional survey. However, the feedback from the optional survey and that mailed survey were kept separate. So we will be focusing on the results of that mail survey tonight, but you should have each received a copy of those supplemental results from the optional survey as well in your packets. As a quick refresher for everyone here, the National Citizen Survey report assesses overall livability of Kerrville. The survey captured resident opinions across 8 different areas of community, which are shown here and include safety, mobility, the natural environment, the built environment, economy, recreation and wellness, education and enrichment, and community engagement. And in each one of those 8 domains, residents reported their perceptions about the quality of their community, how well we as a city government are delivering services in each of those areas, as well as their own engagement within the community. And we will compare the results in each of these domains to the results of other similar municipalities across the country who also use the National Citizen Survey. And all that combined data is how the National Research Center sets its national benchmarks and is useful in understanding how Kerrville compares to other cities in terms of the overall quality of life that we offer our citizens. Looking at the overall ratings the city received, a vast majority of survey respondents, 80%, gave excellent or good ratings to the overall quality of life in Kerrville. 84% of respondents rated the city as a good or excellent place to live. And as you will see in a few slides, more than 80% of respondents also positively rated their neighborhoods as a place to live and the city as a place to retire. This is all excellent news when you consider the overall livability of Kerrville, and we'll break down several of the reasons why Kerrville residents may have rated the city so highly in more of the slides to come. Also important to note, about 4 in 5 respondents indicated they would recommend Kerrville to someone who asked, and a similar proportion indicated they plan to remain in Kerrville for at least the next 5 years. Additionally, about 6 in 10 residents gave an excellent or good rating to the overall sense of community in Kerrville, which again is an excellent indicator of the overall livability here in Kerrville. So in addition to rating the city as a place to live, respondents also rated several aspects of the overall community, including quality, including Kerrville as a place to live and raise children and to retire, their neighborhood as a place to live, and the overall image or reputation of Kerrville and its overall appearance. About 3/4 of survey participants awarded high marks to the city as a place to raise children and to the overall image and appearance of Kerrville, while about 8 in 10 favorably rated their neighborhood as a place to live, and all of those ratings were strong and similar to the national benchmark comparisons. A large majority of respondents, 83%, gave an excellent or good rating to Kerrville as a place to retire, which is a much higher rating than seen in many of the comparable communities. And again, all of these are attributes that likely contribute to those high levels of satisfaction and overall quality of life that we saw on previous slides. So when you dig into some of the more specific results, the citizen survey started out by asking respondents to rate various community characteristics, which include more than 40 features of the community. Each of those features fall under one of those eight facets of community livability, which we discussed earlier. If you'll remember, those eight areas included topics like mobility, safety, transportation, et cetera. And you can consider each of the community features rated in this section subgroups of those larger topics. And shown here are the top five community characteristics as rated by participants of that survey. On the topic of safety, overall, 85% of residents favorably rated the feeling of safety in Kerrville, which isn't shown here. But what is shown here is about 9 in 10 of the respondents gave high marks to the feeling of safety in their neighborhood and in the downtown or commercial areas of town. Also, at least 3/4 of respondents gave good or excellent ratings to all aspects of the natural environment in Kerrville. That includes the overall natural environment, which is shown on the slide, because 88% of respondents rated it excellent or good. And it also includes characteristics like the cleanliness of the city, which received high ratings from 75% of respondents. Community characteristics also scoring high marks were the availability of religious or spiritual events in the community and the overall ease of travel around Kerrville, which again tend to be similar to the national benchmark comparisons. And not shown here but worth mentioning, all aspects of recreation and wellness, education and enrichment, and community engagement received excellent or good ratings from at least 4 in 10 respondents, and again, were similar to their national benchmark comparisons. So they did very well as well. They just didn't crack necessarily the top five in this particular section. On this slide, you can see the community characteristics that survey respondents did not rate as positively and are potential areas for improvement. Although overall ease of travel in the city received high marks, as you saw on that last slide, ratings with regard to the domain of mobility in Kerrville varied widely. As you see on this slide, the city received a low rating of 21% for ease of travel by public transportation. Ratings for this particular characteristic are lower in Kerrville than in other communities nationwide, according to that benchmark set by the National Research Center. Also notable, only 24% of respondents favorably rated the availability of employment opportunities in Kerrville, a rating which is similar to the national benchmark, and only about 1/3 of residents or less favorably rated new development in Kerrville, the availability of affordable quality housing, and the variety of housing options. And ratings for all three of those aspects were lower than ratings seen in other cities which use the National Citizen Survey. About half of the respondents or more did give high marks to the overall economic health of Kerrville, the quality of business and service establishments in the city, and the city as a place to visit, and Kerrville as a place to work, which is all good news with regard to economy. However, only about 25% of participants favorably rated the vibrancy of Kerrville's downtown or commercial areas and the available shopping opportunities. And ratings for both of those aspects were lower than ratings seen elsewhere. And again, this is just a quick snapshot of the five community characteristics which received the highest and the lowest ratings of satisfaction from respondents in this area. Survey participants were again asked to rate a total of 45 community characteristics in all, and the city of Kerrville rated at least similarly to the national benchmark on 38 of those 45 characteristics, and one of which is shown here on the bottom few slides. So after assessing those overall community characteristics, the National Citizen Survey then asked the participants to rate the quality of government services that the city of Kerrville currently provides. And as a general overview of services, 7 in 10 residents gave high marks to the quality of services provided by the city of Kerrville and the overall customer service provided by Kerrville employees. That's 75%. So that's great news, especially considering that only 4 in 10 residents gave positive ratings to the quality of services provided by the federal government. And additionally, 2 in 5 residents positively rated the value of services for taxes paid. The overall direction Kerrville is taking and the job the city does at welcoming citizen involvement and being honest. Continuing under that area of quality of governance, when evaluating the overall quality of city services, respondents were asked to evaluate more than 30 individual services and amenities that are currently available in Kerrville, and respondents rated these 5 services the highest. As you can see, many of our safety services were rated very highly, with both fire and EMS services receiving more than 90% good or excellent ratings, and police services receiving 84% good or excellent ratings for its services. About 8 in 10 respondents also highly rated the overall quality of our city parks and the power utility, so we're delivering great service in those areas and many more that aren't listed here. Again, it's just the top 5. Here you will see the service areas which received the lowest marks, mirroring some of those themes we saw under the community characteristics. Bus or transit services only received a positive rating from about 20% of respondents. Also under that larger category of mobility, only 26% of respondents positively rated the city's street repair services, both of which are lower than that national benchmark. Another area where citizens indicated there may be room for potential improvement is the area of code enforcement. About 36% of residents positively rated those services, which is similar to other municipalities. And with regard to both the street repair and code enforcement, it is important to keep in mind that we are currently in the midst of a multi-year street maintenance program, which does aim to bring all of our roads up to a much higher standard. And the city also just brought on a new code enforcement officer, actually in the midst of the survey at the end of last year. So those are factors that may not have been taken into account or be fully seen at the time that this survey was taken. Other areas that did receive low marks were economic development and land use planning and zoning. However, both of those areas, the ratings they received were similar to the national benchmark. And again, overall, participants were asked to evaluate a total of 34 different city services and amenities, and in all, the city of Kerrville rated similarly to the national benchmark on 30 of those 34 characteristics, 3 of which are shown on this slide. So based on all that data contained in our final report of results, what I've presented to you today, it's clear that Kerrville is doing very well at delivering services in certain areas, while other areas could potentially use some additional attention. And on this page, I have outlined the areas of community livability that respondents indicated we are currently successful in. As you may have noticed as we were going through, public safety rated very highly in a number of categories. Both fire and EMS and police ratings were in 80 to 90% range. And additionally, what was not shown on there, 4 in 5 participants indicated they had not reported a crime in the 12 months before the survey, and 9 in 10 participants had not been the victim of a crime in the 12 months before taking that survey. Also rated highly was the natural environment in Kerrville. Respondents indicated that Kerrville is a beautiful place to live and visit, with the river and the hills, and about 70% of respondents also highly rated the current available trash and recycling services that the city offers. The survey results also indicated that the city of Kerrville has a good level of community engagement. If you'll remember that 60% of residents gave excellent or good ratings to the sense of community in Kerrville. But additionally, what was not shown in the presentation is that more than 50% of citizens also indicated that they volunteer within the community. And this is a higher level of volunteering than many of the other communities that have participated in the National Citizen Survey typically have experienced. We were above the benchmark there. The survey data also indicated a majority of respondents paid close attention to local news, regularly interact with their neighbors, and have participated in local elections. Then moving on, under the facet of education and enrichment, the local K-12 school system and availability of cultural events, city-sponsored events, and spiritual or religious events were also very highly rated. About 66% of respondents indicated they have participated in religious or spiritual activities, which is also higher than that national benchmark. So the survey results also indicated the area of recreation and wellness is a strength for the city. Respondents highly rated both city parks and the availability of fitness and recreation opportunities, among other things. Now, on this page, I've outlined the areas of community livability where respondents indicated the city could potentially have some improvement. You may have noticed as we went through the presentation that many of the lowest rated services and community characteristics fell in the domains of mobility, economy, and the built environment. And as we discussed, only about 25% of participants favorably rated the vibrancy of Kerrville's downtown or commercial areas and the available shopping opportunities, and ratings for both of those aspects were lower than seen elsewhere. Additionally, only 24 respondents favorably rated the availability of employment opportunities, which is similar to the national benchmark. And it's also important to remember, on the topic of economy, Kerrville did receive good ratings as a place to visit, as a place to work, and the overall quality of business and service establishments within the city. So the domain does have its areas of success, but it also has several areas that citizens indicated there could be some improvement. On the topic of mobility, street repair, street cleaning, and public transportation, all rated lower than the national benchmark. And with regard to the built environment in Kerrville, a number of areas including affordable quality housing, housing options, new development, and storm drainage also fell short on that national benchmark. So the areas of code enforcement and land use planning and zoning also received low marks, but they were, again, similar to the national benchmark. So all of this feedback will be very useful as we move forward with the long-range planning process for the city of Kerrville, and there are some areas of great strength the city will definitely want to maintain and protect as we move forward into future years, and some areas where additional attention or resources may potentially be helpful.
You forgot to say that 85 portions of fruits and vegetables.
That was in there too. It was a lot of data, and this, like I said, was just some of the key takeaways.
I lost confidence in the whole thing when I read that.
When you read that, yeah.
That's that they really do.
Yes.
No, I appreciate that. I think there's a few interesting things in here that we can work into our comprehensive plan. I must say that I'm not very surprised by a lot of these results. There were the things we thought were good, we were right about things we thought we needed improvement, we do. One of them was, you know, being honest in government, the 14%, you know, had a problem with that in the online survey. So we have to work on our affordable housing, public transportation when it becomes available, Karen, and our street cleaning and drainage. I am encouraged that 96% of the people say they shop here, and most of the people are very happy with the parks, libraries, special events, solid waste, utilities, law enforcement, first responders. Y'all are all doing a wonderful job. So that is a good thing. The one thing that surprised me that I know, although they had a feeling of general security, people were worried about emergency preparedness. And Chief Smith and I discussed this after the workshop, and he has done in the past, and I believe is working on a presentation just to let you know that things are covered, and he will prepare something for the public to see to let you know that we are prepared in case of an emergency event, and so that may alleviate that worry.
We also need to bring new businesses to town, or get the businesses that are here to expand, and be sure that we interface with all the others in the community that are working in that area, because jobs and pay were clearly an area that were addressed, and I don't think we can do it by ourselves, but I think if we get together with everybody else, we've got a good story to tell and a lot to be gained there with just a few good things falling our way.
And again, we'll have a new city planner coming on board to work on the comprehensive plan, I assume, soon, and city management. So there's some transition areas here, and I expect we'll get traction when all that comes into place.
One of the things I really like about this is, well, two aspects. One is the statistical significance and accuracy of this. You know, we're at 95% confidence interval is plus or minus 4%, which is very good on a survey. And the second is the comparison data we have against national standards. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you see a number and you say, oh, wow, that's real high, that's real low. But sometimes there's just a built-in bias by those of us that are citizens to rate something higher, to rate something low. And so you really need to be, that another aspect of it is, I understand what the mayor said, that the 33 people who are self-chosen rated us lower, but I think our overall rating on honesty in the city government was significantly higher than the 14%.
40%.
40%. So that is statistically significant. People who self-select is important, and we got to listen to that, but there also comes with what's called a huge passion bias. And so the part of the data I'm really, really focused on, and I hope the council continues to focus on, are the statistically significant data, which is the randomly selected people. And so I'm very pleased. There's a couple things about the street. I think one of the points that needs to be made, and if you said it, I missed it. If my numbers are right, from 2016 to 2017, in response of knowing the incredible job that the engineering firm, I think Rude or however you pronounce the name, R-O-U, Ruddy or whatever, we've increased the dollars, 16 to 17, 66%, you know, which is a huge increase in 1 year of trying to catch up with road repairs. Not that we don't need to do it, but there has been a response to that. You made a good point, I think an excellent point, Caitlin, about we've got a new code enforcement. That was a demand by the council back in our meeting in July or August. That will, as opposed to waiting for those of us that are citizens can call and say that Stephen Fine's house is really trashed, we'll now have a proactive step on that. And particularly the thing we're looking for is about to happen when the green starts busting out all over and the weeds and the grass start to grow, and we can be proactive in that as opposed to waiting for complaint. So I think there's a lot of good data here. It sets us up well for figuring the top level where we see ourselves in 10 or 15 years and how to improve that. And I deeply appreciate the decision by this council and the decision by KEDC to donate to this survey.
Any other comments by council or the audience? Having heard none, thank you very much for your presentation. We'll move on to item 6C, the Scenic City Certification Program. Mr. Pine.
This came about as a result of the TML conference of February 16th, 17th, and 18th up in Allen, Texas. Scenic City Certification Program is a program that's actually part of Scenic America. It's different. It's still under the Texas Historical Commission. The reason I'm bringing this before council is this kind of goes back to the workshop about bringing things before council to discuss it before I take it to staff and say, do research. Because in talking with the lady at the conference, her name was Ann Culver, we talked about a lot of our ordinances. What they actually do is they look at your ordinance in different areas, such as landscaping and dark skies. There's a whole criteria you go through, so it is an application process. The cities are actually rated platinum, gold, silver, bronze, and recognized. And it encourages the communities to make their ordinances better to keep the scenic part of the city, I guess is the best way to put it. Keep your cities clean, keep your cities nice, and then in response to that, you're given obviously a designation, signage that would go on your city limits signs, and also recognition by them. And it's I don't know the actual age of the program, how long it's been around, but I thought if this was something the city wanted to look at, I don't think it's going to take an overwhelming amount of time. And speaking with Ms. Culver, and I believe she would actually be, or someone from her office would be willing to come down and make a presentation to council if they so desired, looking into this further. It would be in the part that I read and discussed with her, I think, she felt that Kerrville would have no problem qualifying at probably one of the higher levels with everything we already have with the river trail. That, when I explained to her some of the amenities and some of the things we were already doing, she said we would probably be, you know, up near the top. But before I asked staff to do any research at all, I wanted on the agenda to if y'all wanted to discuss it, if it's something you thought was worthwhile, in pursuing for the city.
I noticed it says here roadways and public spaces, but then it says recognizing infrastructure standards. Does it require, because we've talked about this before, maintenance ordinances? Because that is a very difficult thing to...
Bonnie, I don't know because we didn't get into it. And that's what I'm saying. If it's something we want to pursue, and if you want me to have staff get with Ms. Culver or me to get with Ms. Culver, and I just, that's why I'm brought this forward, is to discuss it.
I think it's something we ought to explore. I mean, certainly would like to hear more about it. It's like the scenic rivers and all of those. When you get that designation, there is a respect and there is an interest and there is an, you know, so we can, any way we can do to elevate the Kerrville name and Kerrville reputation and Kerrville trademark seems to be, especially if it's not a lot, if it doesn't cost a lot of money and time, I'd encourage us to go do it.
I have a list of cities on here that, and they range from small towns to all the way up to Fort Worth. Who are on it, who have applied for it. College Station is on here. And anyway, I just wanted to bring it before council so we could just, you'll see the list.
If they wanted to come and maybe do a presentation so that we could see if there's application fees or, you know, if it requires maintenance ordinances. It's one thing that I get calls about all the time. You know, somebody's car is parked in the yard or somebody's got trash everywhere in their yard. And speaking with Mr. Parton about it before, certainly it is something that you want to take, you know, note of, but, you know, how to do that and not be selective. So, but if they wanted to come and give a presentation.
And that's why I believe there's different levels. Mm-hmm. So if you wanted to, you know, shoot for the platinum level, you probably would have to have, or you not probably, you would have to have a lot stricter ordinances than we probably have in place today. But at the same time, you know, looking at some of the cities on here and having driven through some of these cities, I'm not cutting them down by any means, but I feel very strongly Kerrville would qualify for this program relatively easily. So,
what does the program do?
If you have a question, you're welcome to come to the platform, to the podium.
If y'all want to pursue it, we can ask more questions or when I have more information. This is just a preliminary. Does council want to pursue something with it? That's all this is.
This is the report on, so there's no action.
Right.
So
there's no action.
You're looking for a consensus, I assume. Well,
yeah, looking for an idea. Is it something we think would be worthwhile for the city? And at that point in time, we can bring more back and more information.
If they have a presentation to give them, we can learn more about it and see what, you know, the requirements are.
Okay,
sure.
All right.
Certainly.
Okay.
I just wanted to get council approval, let them know that I was doing that before I went out and did it. So,
Very good. If there's no more comments on that, item number 60, Ms. Yarbrough's budget and economic update.
This is the financial report ending January 31st for the general fund. The current month revenues was $5,691,059, bringing our year-to-date total of $12,344,089. Our expenditures for the month in the general fund was $1,730,371, with our year-to-date of being $8,028,708. In the water sewer fund, the revenue for the month was $869,251, with our year-to-date revenue of being $3,806,721. Our expenditures for the month was $838,787, our year-to-date of being $3,780,017. In the hotel motel fund, the revenue for the month was $66,804. With our year-to-date of being $364,785. Our expenditures for the month was $10,000, and our year-to-date was $689,950. And I might point out that our property tax has came in much faster this year than it did last year. So that is definitely a plus.
See, we're at 69%?
Yes, ma'am, compared to last year. Under the economic part, under the community investment plan, I have five projects there showing the project budget, the current expenses of the month, the project to date expense, and the project balances. Under development services, in the month of January, they issued 4 new residential permits and $3,500,000 in commercial value permits. The housing market and the revenue, I mean, in the real estate, is staying consistent. It's a little lower than it's been the past couple of months, but I understand that it's back up in this month of talking to some realtors. Our unemployment is holding steady as it has for over a year now. And at the bottom, I added our current utility account so y'all could see the types of resident, commercial, and irrigation that we're serving and the number of units.
Good news.
Thank you.
Yep.
Any questions, comments? Thank you, Ms. Yarbrough. So item number 7A is appointment to the Kerrville Kirk County Joint Airport Board. Ms. Craig?
We have one term that's due to expire June 1st, 2017, and this is due to a resignation. The airport board's recommendation and the application are before you tonight for consideration. The Kerr County Commissioners Court approved Mr. Mark Mosier for appointment yesterday, February 27th, and this item is also posted for executive session if council so desires.
Thank you very much. Council, I'm good with open session decision, and I believe Dr. Mosier and Mr. McKenzie are here this evening, and he's waded through all of this in case we have any questions. We did read your application, and well qualified. Matter of fact, all of the applicants I understand would have been excellent and well qualified, but Dr. Mosier has been at a lot of the meetings and seems to be very engaged, and I would make a motion that we do as the county did and approve Dr. Mosier for this seat.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. All in favor, please raise your hand. Carries 4-0. Thank you for waiting so much, and thank you for your service. Item number 7B is appointment to the Kerrville Public Utility Board. Ms. Craig?
Okay. Kerrville Public Utility Board trustee position 4 is currently held by Philip Stacy, and it expires April 21st this year. KPUB has submitted 3 nominations, and those applications are before you for consideration tonight. All 3 members meet the nominees meet the qualifications for membership, and this item is also posted for executive session if council so desires.
Thank you, Ms. Craig. And again, I'm good with open session unless there's any objections. Hearing none, I am the representative member from the council to KPUB. And I want to let everyone know I did talk with all 3 applicants. I have served with Mr. Stacy, and I believe that because of the experience level that he has there, that he would be, again, all very good nominees, all very willing to serve. At least one of them, probably both of the others beside Mr. Stacy, understand that he has had the training and the experience level, and they just wanted to make their services available, and perhaps in the future, should we decide to reappoint Mr. Stacy, they are still available at that point in time. That having been said, I would move that we reappoint Philip Stacy to the board of KPUB.
I second that, after having served with him for the first 4 years of his term, so he's a very good asset for that board.
And again, it's a very, very involved board and very detailed, and it does take some expertise and training in particular for the utilities section of our government here. So that having been said, we have a motion and we have a second. All in favor? Passes 4-0. Items for future agenda, number 8. Does anyone have any items for a future agenda?
I've been in contact with actually Chief Smith and Don Davis, and I spoke the other day, and we'll be bringing an item hopefully to the next meeting with regards to driving and texting. Mr. Nemke, I know this is very near and dear to you. We have been talking about it, and it will be, hopefully we'll have something to discuss a little bit more detail on the 14th
Yes, Mr. Fine, my understanding was we will go beyond just the texting and address the use of handheld devices.
Handheld devices, period, yes.
Yeah, okay.
And then we also had a discussion with regards to vaping, and I think the chief, I'm not gonna put words in his mouth because I don't see him here, Knight really wanted a little bit more direction from council with regards to adding vaping to the non-smoking, or to the smoking or non-smoking ordinance, in what level of detail the direction came from council due to the ability or inability to enforce those regulations. And there still is, you know, I've gotten a lot of information from Mr. Morgan, who is also not here tonight, with regards to vaping, and some of it looked, what he sent me doesn't look good at all. But at the same time, I think Chief Knight was really wanting more direction from council on that before we pursued, so we could get both of those on the agenda.
What we may do, since that specifically is not on the agenda tonight, but we'll put it on, and maybe we want to put it on as a discussion item on the 14th, right, so y'all can get a little better understanding of the nature of that, and then go from there.
And we want to put the scenic cities on in the future.
Sure. Okay, yeah, scenic cities will come back, and I'll be in contact with Ms. Culver, and hopefully we can get more information for everybody.
Okay. If there are none others for future agenda items, we will go back up to the top for the visitors forum. I have several speaker requests for them. Catherine Palmer. Yes, ma'am.
I'm Catherine Palmer, Kerrville residence. I live at 120 Travis. And this is my very first council meeting. And it's highly enlightening as well as disturbing. And what's disturbing to me, number one, is it appeared to me that there was quite a bit of more than a majority of good input for keeping the visitors' responses at the beginning of the meeting. And yet, it didn't appear that not one single councilman cared about that. And I think that is really sad at best. Now, my sheet shows that my primary concern, and I believe this is, if I'm not mistaken, this happened once prior, but most recently, there were 11 people who applied for a seat, which I believe this fine gentleman has. And according to the paper, two of those 11 qualified, acceptable people had been voted by the general public. In other words, they had received support of the general public saying, we would like for you to represent, and that was totally ignored by the councilman when it came time to choose. And I would like to hear from the councilman as to why you would do this. I mean, it just boggled my mind. I thought, well, my goodness, why wouldn't you choose one of two people who the public had already said, we would like this individual to represent? Would you please, each of you, respond?
We cannot respond.
We can have a discussion on citizens' items, unless it's on the agenda. We can individually respond to you at another time.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you.
If you'd like to call, I'll be more than happy to explain my position.
Thank you. I look forward to hearing your response.
One of the things, just as a point, that we can talk with fact, there's very little that we can say about what was said because all of it was said in executive council. So if you start to ask questions, we have to be very careful what we say because that's a felony on our part if we reveal what's said in executive session. Huh?
Misdemeanor.
It's a misdemeanor?
Yeah.
I thought it was a felony. It used to be a felony.
Thank you very much for coming, though, and we appreciate it. Welcome. Okay.
Come again.
Yeah, Jerry Wolf.
Come again.
You're kidding.
No, please do.
And we're on television if you want to watch it at home.
I'm Jerry Wolf, and I live at 509 North Buckboard, and I hope I don't suck the rest of the air out of the room. I'm here tonight to talk, Mayor, about something from 5 months ago. I brought the issue before council, I think it was on the agenda, to talk about irrigation water rates. And it's been bantered about, and I know Mr. Parton was a proponent of 65 cents per 1,000 gallons. And I ran some numbers, and I distributed those in a spreadsheet form to members of council. Mr. Andrew that night and I started having a little bit of a discussion about it, and he said, right now, we're not ready to talk about this. We need to look into it a little bit more, and we'll put this back on the agenda, and we'll talk about it again. Well, 5 months have elapsed, and this item has not appeared on the agenda. I still have my spreadsheet. It's been updated with the latest cost numbers, such as the $1.5 million increase in the pipeline cost to put a larger line into Comanche Trace. But this also, part of this issue, a side issue that goes with the cost of the irrigation water, is also that Comanche Trace 17-year contract was gone, terminated in last August. And I believe it's going to be going on a month-to-month basis. I'm sure Mr. Davis can inform us of what that situation is. With that contract, too, which I brought this issue up, Comanche Trace owes the city, by contract of that contract that was signed approximately in 2000, year 2000, the Comanche Trace was going to deed over two water wells and half of their senior water rights to the Guadalupe River to the city as part of the agreement. That in the return, that the city of Kerrville would build a irrigation water pipeline to Comanche Trace and furnished irrigation water. I have no idea about where that stands. I think it's time that the city concludes that part of the contract, that those deeds be issued and come into city's possession. So I'm asking, when will you put this item on the agenda, and I'll be happy again to distribute my spreadsheet to you beforehand, members of council, and we can have a discussion. The rate right now at 65 cents is approximately only 20% of the cost of delivering that water to Comanche Trace and River Hills, who are about half. They will purchase 52%, according to Todd Parton's projections, of the irrigation water. That means the drinking water customers of Kerrville will bear the burden of the cost of that irrigation water, which also means the pond. So I look forward to seeing this item on the agenda in the very near future, and I'll hold Mr. Andrew to what he had told me 5 months ago. Thank you.
It is something we did say we'd look into. Thank you very much. I don't have any more speaker request form. I have just a letter that I will just quickly summarize, because it was written to me as the mayor, and obviously for everyone to enjoy who lives in the city of Kerrville in Kirk County. It doesn't happen always that somebody takes time to do this, and this is a kudo for where we live. And it's a man named Dustin Fleming and his wife Maddie Fleming from Oceanside, California. They were coming through here on a cross-country journey, moving from one location to another, and had car trouble. And he wants to commend Chris Bourne of Midway Wrecker Service. He treated us with such hospitality, respect, and as if he had known us for his entire life. It started our unfortunate troubles into a positive experience. And number two, the staff at the La Quinta Inn were very accommodating. And number three, the car maintenance department at Crenwell D Motors in particular, he mentioned Kelly, a blonde-headed lady, he said.
and Frank Lynch, who is in the service department. He said, immediately I knew Mr. Lynch was someone we could trust and allow him to guide us in the right direction. He texted us on multiple occasions after we left to ensure that we were safe and our vehicle was functioning properly. Mayor, I write you as a way to communicate our appreciation of these fine folks that make up your city. These type of people are not only what make a great name for the city of Kerrville, but more so the great state of Texas. So this is a good way to end, and I did forward these on to these people and let them know that they're appreciated by somebody out in California.
Great.
Anything else? If not, then item number 10 is slated for executive session. Do I have a motion to move into executive session for real property acquisition and water rights?
I move we move into executive session for 551071, 551072.
Okay. There's second. Been a motion. We have a motion and second. All in favor, please raise your hand. Passes 4-0. So at 7:45, we will adjourn the open session and move into executive session. Thank you all for coming. You're welcome to stay. Let the record show that we are back into open session at 8:50 p.m. And let the record also state there was no action taken in executive session. And with that, we will be adjourned.